I'd like to welcome Dr. Michael Gossweiler. He's a periodontist who graduated both from the Indiana University School of Dentistry and the University of Kentucky College of Dentistry. His journey to overcome various mercury-related health problems led him to establish an integrative dental practice in 2005. He's been a clinical professor and a surgical clinical instructor in the graduate periodontal program at Indiana University School of Dentistry since 1996. He is a graduate of the American College of Integrative Medicine and Dentistry and a member of the American Academy of Periodontology and also a member of the IAOMT. Please welcome Dr. Gossweiler.
Okay, thank you. Well, the lecture, I'm going to apologize straight off the bat because I'm one of these guys that works up until the last minute to prepare a lecture. So it will be uploaded, so you should be able to probably later today get this off of the app, so in case you were looking for it. So let me make sure I got this right here. So Janet already went through my background. I am required to do the AGD disclaimer. I do not have any financial interests of a product in my talk or with any companies offering grant monies for this continuing dental and medical education program. I suppose I have one conflict of interest is that I do work at the dental school where they pay me the big money to work there. This is just our overall goal of the lecture today. My main goal in doing this, though, was really to move the conversation on periodontal disease towards these autoimmune immunological aspects of it, because too often, at least in my role as a faculty at the dental school, of course, everything centers around the infectious aspects of this. Even though we have research people there, and I have these conversations with them who say all the time, oh yes, well, you know, we study toll-like receptors, we understand all of these immunological defects that occur with periodontal disease, yet in terms of the clinical practice, we're still focused on killing bugs. And I know this group is a little bit more advanced in their thinking on this, so I'm going to apologize for some of you, if you're new members, this may seem a bit much. If you're existing members, you may think, this is stuff I already know about. So I do invite comments as we're going through this, but I got a lot of slides, so we're going to try to move quickly. All right, so this is the typical view of periodontal disease where you've got a lot of plaque, calculus, inflammation. And those of you who have been treating perio for a while, you know that a patient like this, you get in, you clean them up, you do basic maintenance, and they'll usually respond rather well. For the physicians in the room, this just gives a little diagrammatic view of periodontal disease and how it progresses. And when I have these conversations with patients, I'm usually sitting down and explaining to them that the difference between here and here is that you simply have inflammation, where the disease is not yet breaking down the bone, and of course, as you start to progress, both of these are, both gingivitis and periodontitis are associated with bacteria. However, in this particular one, your body's response to the bacteria is to break you down. And patients usually get that. I mean, they don't have a problem trying to comprehend that. But I want them to understand, because a lot of times people will come in and they'll be frustrated because, you know, I've been doing this gum therapy with my dentist, or I've been to two other periodontists already and they've done two surgeries and I'm still losing bone around the teeth. Like, what are you going to do to help me? So by having that conversation that this is not necessarily just about brushing and cleaning, then the patient automatically starts to back off a little bit and starts to think, oh, okay, well, this is some other aspect that people haven't really talked to me about. As some of the earlier speakers were talking about, you know, all of us who are doing this really kind of stand on the shoulders of people who came before us. And one of the guys who got me interested back in 2005 looking at kind of the metabolic aspects to this was Sam Queen. And any of you who've done any of the CCN training probably know Sam. Sam's brilliant in terms of his ability to look at blood chemistries. He does this thing where he can take a blood chemistry and he'll just go down and then he won't even know you. He'll just look at you and say, well, how long have you had problems sleeping? And people will just, wow, okay, that's incredible that he can do that. Sam's still alive. He's down in Florida. But he used to do this thing called mouthful of evidence. And the mouthful of evidence, he talks about the six metabolic defects. And he was pointing out how periodontal disease have all of these defects. All right. So that got me just thinking about perio in terms of metabolics, but not really in much in the way of immunologics. Anyone who's treated periodontal disease for any amount of time, you'll have those patients, like I said, where you go in, you do your scaling and root planing, you do your initial therapy, patients respond well, but then every once in a while you get a patient like this. And this patient, she's 59 years old, never smoked, good control of her blood sugar, has a relatively clean diet, no refined sugar, low carb, gluten-free. She does vitamin supplementation. She works for a compounding pharmacy. I mean, everyone in that compounding pharmacy is kind of oriented in that same fashion. But yet, she's been losing bone around the teeth despite excellent oral hygiene. So in this particular instance, these are the kind of patients where early in my career, I just didn't know what to do with them. And the literature actually describes these types of patients, these non-inflammatory periodontal disease patients. Now, just real quick, for the dentist in the room, looking at this picture, what do you notice about this picture? I'm sorry? Go ahead. Open bite. Open bite, yeah. I mean, she's hitting in the posterior, but so what does that tell you? I'm sorry? Compressed? She may have tongue thrusting, but what's the other thing? I'm thinking more in structural terms.
Low power bone.
I'm sorry?
Low power bone.
Okay, I'm kind of going around it. Basically, if you did a CBCT on this patient, what you'd find is that she's having breakdown of the TMJ. She has arthritic changes going on. So it's not just that she's losing attachment around the teeth. I mean, she's physically coming in, and she's got all these back problems, joint problems. Basically, you know, her joints are breaking down. All right. And, you know, we run these bacterial oral DNA tests, and she's relatively clean. So, you know, in essence, she's got an immunological problem. But, you know, I've been trying to get her to go see the integrative physician that I work with, and she's like, well, no, it's not that bad yet. I don't know how bad it has to get before you actually end up doing something about it. But, you know, she originally presented with periodontal attachment loss problems. In fact, in those lower anterior teeth, we go back and take a look here. I mean, her primary concern when she first came in was that she was getting recession down in here. You know. And, of course, at that point in my career, I was just thinking, okay, well, do surgery, do grafting. You know, we did a connective tissue graft on those teeth, which, okay, fine, she's got attached gingiva, but she's still losing attachment around the teeth. So how we treat these problem, of course, is based on what we think the driving force behind the disease is. So there are certain things we think we know about periodontal disease. Continuum of related conditions, there's associated risk factors, different aspects to the disease. I tend to think of it in just simple terms of being metabolic, infectious, and immunologic. And of course, we know about different treatments to reduce at least the clinical signs, scaling and root planing. I mean, you know, the classic things that we learn in dental school. Now, of course, in this group, I'm sure most of you who are treating your perio patients are doing it on a more holistic basis, of course. When I first got to this group as a periodontist walking in here, you know, I thought, I've got this all nailed down. I mean, I've learned more from this group than I think, frankly, than I did in dental school. So we know a lot about the various bacteria, cytokines, enzymes, genetics, risk factors associated with periodontal attachment loss and the various ways in which they're related and connected. What we don't know is how to put this information together in a model and treatment protocol that can accurately diagnose real-time disease. And that's the point. I mean, we can do these bacterial tests, we can do all these other things, but it usually it's only telling us about the damage that's either already been done or about maybe the bacteria. And we'll get into, you know, just looking at bacteria. So we're often limited by our ability to see the whole picture. Okay, so part of the problem is we're still using the same technology as we were using back in the 1880s to diagnose periodontal disease, at least the way that we're doing it at the dental schools. So you say, oh, but I've got a microscope. I got a phase contrast microscope. Well, congratulations, you moved into the 1930s, okay? I mean, don't get me wrong. I mean, I think microscopes are fine. But I just think that, you know, we can also be misled just by looking at just the bacteria. Now, I have to explain this next slide because my wife is Venezuelan. She said, I don't get that. She says, do you know the parable of the blind men and the elephant? Are you familiar with that? I'm seeing some head shaking, okay. Basically, you know, can't really tell what the whole picture is. So basically, for periodontal disease, I think of this as, you know, this is perio, and this is us trying to figure out what perio is about. So for any given patient that presents in our office with bone loss, well, there are certain things we need to try to figure out. Is the bone loss due to periodontal disease? It's not always due to periodontal disease. Primary traumatic occlusion, you can have endoperio problems, you can have iatrogenic problems. So, you know, we don't want to be misled by the mere fact that there's simply bone loss. There's other causes of bone loss. And what type of periodontal entity is at play? Progressive versus quiescent. And if it is progressive, how quickly is it moving? I always tell patients, you know, when I'm doing my examination, well, you know, how quickly is this going to happen? I don't know. I mean, this is like me taking a picture of a train. You can see a picture of a train, but you don't know, you know, is it moving? You can see that it's on the tracks, but that's about it. Which aspects of the disease is predominant? Is the metabolic, infectious, immunologic aspects? And then, of course, what's the best treatment approach? And that's going to be based on what we think is driving it. So, again, I'm like David Quigg. I see things better in pictures. So really, going back and looking at this, I really want to call this more the bioregulatory model of periodontal disease. So I was told that you should always tell a story. So here's the story. Once upon a time, I don't know if he's in here or not. If he's not, we can talk about him. In a strange foreboding mouth somewhere in Bergen County, there resides a lonely tooth that hides a secret within its sulcus known as the dentogingival junction. And beneath the junction lies an area known as the extracellular matrix. Now, any of you who've done the naturopath training know that, you know, everything's centered. For the physicians in the room, you know, this is part and parcel of what you guys understand and work with every day. But for me as a dentist coming in and learning about this, it was something like, oh, you know, now everything starts to make sense. So for those of you who are not familiar with this, there's this difference between complementary medicine, obviously, and bioregulatory medicine. I don't want to... Those of you who practice this on a daily basis are familiar with all the tenets of how this is different versus regular allopathic medicine. But, you know, I have to say that when I first got into this, I was just kind of feeling around, and I was fortunate enough to come into contact with a functional medicine doctor who was helping me with my health issues at the time. And, I mean, for a lot of us, that's how we start out. I mean, we've got some problem, some disease, we've got the shakes, we've got some weird autoimmune disease going, and then somebody helps us out, and we're thinking, okay, this is the way to go. The extracellular matrix, contiguous histological entity, conduit for communication. It's basically what all this, I mean, for me, it really helps to explain how periodontal disease progresses and how it sometimes maintains itself. As a biophysical filter, it serves to allow nutrients to be transferred from the circulatory system to the cells, conduct metabolic waste products away from the cells, act as a trap for toxins moving through the circulation so that they don't reach the cells. So this is the stage upon which all of our action takes place, right? And, well, let me see here. If you, when you're studying this, at least when I was doing the naturopath training, and you look about the risk factors that are connected with the ECM, and then you've studied perio, you start to realize all these things, the nutrition, the toxins, the stress, oxygen, maybe not the hydration, but, you know, all these things are what we know are risk factors associated with periodontal disease as well. So, you know, getting back to what Sam had been talking about all those years about how perio is demonstrating an autoimmune disease, well, you know, this just fits right in with that. So there are certain physical factors that influence the health and function of the extracellular matrix. We have the microbiome, we have the barrier. I mean, David Quigg's lecture earlier today, I think that was excellent with these secretory IgAs and about, you know, have these different layers of defense. You have the immune cells, you have the dendritic cells, we'll go into this. And then, of course, you have the genetics. And you have the, of course, under the genetics, you have SNPs, but you also have syndromic conditions. I mean, these are not as common, but occasionally, I mean, I get patients referred to me for some of these syndromic conditions. And then, of course, we have the SNPs, the single nucleotide polymorphisms. And so here, just showing the genetics, how this can influence the barrier epithelium, the defense. And then, of course, these two can influence the microbiome. So again, I'm just trying to set up this model. We'll go into more detail on this. So this is just putting it all together with this, these modifiable risk factors and how these can then influence the ECM. So we're going to talk about the microbiome first. So just in general terms, we live in this symbiotic relationship with these beneficial bacteria that live on our skin and our GI tract. Cells of our microbiome outnumber us. You know, for the physicians in the room, this is all probably just regular stuff, all right? The gut microbiome constitutes an acquired organ that carries out several different vital functions. We derive a lot of benefits from the gut microbiomes. We glean these ingredients from food, synthesizing nutritional factors such as vitamins, helps detoxify deleterious xenobiotics. It also affects our metabolic type. It helps us develop a robust systemic and internal immune system. You know, that these experiments they do with abiotic rats, you know, they never develop a gallt because they don't have a microbiome. Provides signals for epithelial renewal that may help to maintain gut integrity. And secrete antimicrobial products which negatively select against pathogenic bacteria through the development of colonization resistance. So, how do we benefit them? Of course, well, we give them food, and we provide them with a protected environment in which they can thrive. So, frankly, we get the better end of the deal. Of course, when we're eating, drinking, and exercising, or not exercising, we're determining what kind of neighborhood we're creating for these bacteria. So we want the residents to be diverse, cooperative, and commensal. That is, basically, we don't want them trashing up the place. All right, so microbiome diversity, second only to the gut, at least in the mouth. And we really only know about half. I mean, we suspect that there may be over 1,000 species, and this is based on the this ribosomal, what is it, R16 rDNA analysis. because we're not able to culture all the different types that are in the mouth. It's not just bacteria that seek to colonize the oral cavity. We've got viruses, protozoa, fungi, just the same as you do for the gut. Bacterial community of the mouth is dominated by these particular phyla, all right? Count for 96% of the species detected. The study, 120 individuals from 12 worldwide locations, found no significant geographical differences between their salivary microbiota, which I thought was interesting. This is the interesting quote, though. Species level identification may not be sufficient. This ties back in, by the way, with David Quigg's lecture, which I thought was, again, excellent. Species level identification may not be sufficient because of the genetic heterogeneity of bacterial species and the strong influence of the environment on phenotype. A combination of, let's see if I get this right, phylogenetic, metagenomic, transcriptomic, proteomic, and metabolomic approaches may be required to fully dissect the host oral microbiome interactions relevant to health and disease. All right, so what does that mean? In other words, because bacterial species can vary a lot, environment plays a big role in whether the bacteria decide to become bad dudes. All right? Your species does not determine your pathogenicity. Activity, however, does. More precise diagnostic tools are needed to determine what kind of activities they're carrying out. So here he was talking about Clostridium. I mean, a lot of times we think Clostridium, not so great, but as he was showing, you know, we need those particular, that particular genus and certain species that are associated with it actually for establishing a commensal bacterial environment. So what kind of species are generally considered commensal? And by the way, I'm just going to put, again, AGD disclaimer. I did not know that we were going to have this company putting these oral probiotics in our bag. I pulled that out and I was like, oh, goodness, all right. Well, it kind of ties in. Streptococcus salivarius K12. All right, I had no idea they were going to do this, so just be clear. Produce bactericides that inhibit the growth of gram-negative facultative anaerobes that are associated with periodontal disease. Oral probiotics of this strain may help to reduce oral halitosis and control pathogenic bacteria. If we assign a defensive role to the commensal bacteria via competitive inhibition, then the oral microbiome becomes essentially our first line of defense. So the question is, should we be trying to kill oral bacteria with antimicrobials such as chlorhexidine, which is, of course, real popular? And I don't know, is anybody using chlorhexidine? No, I think most of us have probably given up on chlorhexidine. Are you familiar with chlorhexidine? Okay, yeah. Chlorhexidine is real popular with general dentists to, you know, if someone gets a little bit of gingivitis, they whip out the chlorhexidine and they start having them rinse with it right away. All right. Of course, there are certain oral bacteria, the physicians know this, that are responsible for converting nitrates to nitrites and then are converted by the host into nitric oxide, which of course is antihypertensive. The use of antimicrobial mouth rinses such as chlorhexidines decrease nitric oxide levels. So basically, we're killing off these bacteria that we need in the mouth. All right. Mechanical control. Even though brushing, you know, can start to reduce the levels of these certain pathogenic bacteria, it doesn't really change the profile. I mean, there's this kind of mentality, at least even in our department, at the periodontal department, well, if you just really get in there, brush, and clean real well, you can reduce these pathogenic bacteria. Not necessarily the case. All right, I just threw this in because when I was going through the mechanical control, I thought this was kind of amusing. You have to be careful about when you're reading studies and about the conclusions that they come to. I mean, you have to look at, like, methods. All right, this looked at the role of oral hygiene as it relates to irritable bowel syndrome as compared to healthy controls. So what they were showing in this study was IBD was associated with an increased incidence of dental caries, oral ulcers, dry mouth, and dental visits. Okay, seems reasonable. frequency of the use of dental floss and breath fresheners at disease onsets was significantly higher in IBS patients. Okay. So this was a survey-based study, by the way. These findings suggest that oral hygiene practices may cause alterations to the flora of the oral mucosa, which can cause an imbalance in the gut microbiome and thereby contribute to the pathogenesis of IBD. Okay, well, maybe, but I mean, this is based on a survey, right? I mean, really, I mean, there was no clinical testing, no analysis, you know, and this is their conclusion, all right? So I'm just saying, there may be some association here, but, you know, we can't just start making these conclusions based on a survey that we do with the patients. All right, so this is our second line, the oral epithelium. Four types of epithelium found in around the teeth. We've got the junctional, sulcular epithelium, keratinized, alveolar. All the dentists, okay, we're familiar with this. Junctional epithelium is kind of interesting. Has this arrangement, and there's this rapid turnover of junctional epithelial cells that produce this funneling effect that prevents the colonization of bacteria and other microbes. Now, of course, if you have a patient who's got problems where they're just, you know, for instance, if they're got high oxidative stress, for instance, they're cancer patients or something like that, then obviously they're going to have a problem with this rapid, you know, any cells that are rapidly turning over, they're going to have problems with. So they can obviously start to have problems where they start to have more recession, problems of that nature. The epithelial cells secrete antimicrobial substances. The epithelial cells exposed to biofilms secrete cytokines that allow the migration of the PMNs into the sulcus. This is kind of our classical periodontal model. When you get a bacterial infection down in around the sulcus here, that you have this big infiltration of PMNs into this area. The keratinized, which is this combination of the attached and free, has this multi-layer effect, all right? The basal layer is basically the wall that keeps the bad dudes out. Their health is a function of the ECM since they are the ones in direct contact with the extracellular matrix. They communicate with one another through various connections called. Any of you that sat for Dr. Quigg's lecture, what was it? Right. There's not just desmosomes. There's a bunch of basal cell connections. There's tight junctions. There's adhering junctions. There's desmosomes. There's gap junctions. And all of these various types of connections communicate different things between the cells. So they have this constant communication going on between them. All right. So they're designed to keep the invaders out, but also allow communication so that they can tell, well, you know, what's the health of my neighbor over here? What kind of mechanical stresses are going on? Are there any physical threats? Really a remarkable system. They also allow the outward migration of innate immune cells into the more superficial layers. So this just gives kind of diagrammatic representation of the epithelium here. So even though the oral tissues have to endure this kind of consistently high microbial burden, healthy individuals exhibit minimal inflammation. The adaptive immune response to the oral tissues is able to discern between microbial infection and colonization and is able to manage it. So this is just this diagrammatic representation of both the adaptive and the innate immune system. And then you have these cells that kind of stand on the border between the two. And then this is just for a review for those of you who have forgotten your immunology about where these immune cells arise. And, you know, when you look at this, where they arise from, then you can also see how this kind of divides out both cell-mediated and humoral-mediated immunology or with immune responses. So, as Dr. Quigg was discussing earlier, you have these dendritic cells that are within the epithelium. The Langerhans cells are basically the macrophages of the epidermis. They engulf, digest, present antigens to the immune system. They allow for more targeted response to foreign invaders. Their counterparts in the dermis are the dermal dendritic cells and the macrophages down here. Then you also have the CD8 cells, which are the cytotoxic or killer T cells. They function to kill cancer cells, infected viruses, express T cell receptors that recognize an antigen. Not the same though as a natural killer T cells. All right, and then we're going to talk about the PMNs. Now the PMNs are really a cell arising from the extracellular matrix, but they will, at least in perio, they're going to actually able to go through the epithelium and migrate into the gingival sulcus in here. And there's this whole well-studied pathway involving interleukin 8 and ICAM-1 where it's able to squeeze through these gap junctions. And that's this neat system where they're able to allow the PMNs to come through and then get into the gingival sulcus so they can have direct interaction with the bacteria in the gingival sulcus. So they're basically the tip of the spear when the body's confronted with these periodontal pathogens in the gingival sulcus. They represent 95% of the leukocytes found, both health and disease. And as mentioned, they can migrate across the junctional epithelium to release their rather toxic contents in an effort to destroy the pathogens. All right, as I mentioned, MMP8, ICAM-1, tightly regulated through various feedback loops, since excess or deficiency can lead to periodontal problems. So it's not just excessive PMN problems, but also if you lack PMNs. So PMN killing is acceptable behavior since it's cell mediated, can be shut down. It's slightly dysregulated, you get gingivitis. If you have a major dysregulatory problems, then you're going to have usually, not always, but usually more problems with bone loss. Let's talk a little bit about the genetics of the PMNs. Most of the major PMN dysregulation problems are related to defects in the ability of the PMNs to migrate into the sulcus or identify and move towards pathogens, basically chemotactic problems. These can either be syndromic or non-syndromic genetic defects. So some of the periodontal disease entities that are associated with syndromic diseases, for the dentist, this goes back to your dental school stuff, Papillon-Lefèvre syndrome, where you have this palmar and plantar keratosis. There's no significant involvement of infection, by the way, with these patients. There's other problems. I'll let you read through that. My wife reminded me, too, also Down's syndrome patients, although not all Down syndromes. I think, and I can't remember which one they have, but I believe they have one of the leukocyte adhesion deficiency types. So, I don't know, probably one of the physicians can educate me on that later. The non-syndromic periodontal genetics, not necessarily a cause of periodontal disease destructions, but you have these genetic polymorphisms or SNPs that can cause the innate immune system to respond in a weak manner in the face of a periodontal challenge. They can also be a failure of the feedback loop to downregulate inflammatory cytokines, you know, once an infection has gotten started. And so what you see is a lot of different studies looking at these various SNPs and then how these are related to a more aggressive type of periodontitis. Just some examples of neutrophil SNPs. There's the formal peptide receptors mediate the chemotactic response of the PMNs towards the bacterial pathogens. And there's various studies looking at these polymorphisms in different groups. And you can find all kinds, actually. You've got interleukin SNPs. Again, this is probably nothing new to the physicians in the room. They control the differentiation of B and T cells in response to antigenic challenge. There are a wide range of these affecting all these various interleukins that are associated with periodontal disease. So, please memorize this. Right? You guys got this, right? Now, I'm just putting this up just to show you how intricately these interleukins are related to one another and how this then attempts to keep the immunologic system in balance. Dr. Yu probably understands this, but it's so if we have no major syndromic genetic defects, our defense barrier And the microbiome systems are truly a marvel of self-regulated systems that are designed to protect us from pathogens, but also designed to protect us from ourselves. So, the self-destructive nature of periodontal disease. So I just wanted to point out a few things that kind of, most of the dentists, I think, in the room get this, but this kind of goes against the thinking at the dental schools. Colonization of the oral cavity by periodontal pathogens does not mean that the individual has or will experience periodontal attachment loss. The susceptibility of the host to experience periodontal attachment loss reflects this interplay between the pathogens, the host immune system, and these environmental factors. In healthy patients, the MMPs are necessary. I mean, we need them in order to recycle, get rid of old dead connective tissue. They influence cell proliferation, migration, adhesion dispersion, differentiation, angiogenesis, apoptosis, host defense. I mean, there's a lot of focus in the periodontal research literature about MMPs and how damaging they are, but I mean, basically we need them. They are prevented from breaking us down completely by the action of inhibitory cytokines and auto-regulating feedback loops. Periodontal attachment loss is primarily the result of the dysregulated action of these MMPs, right? Produced by the host cells, not by the bacteria. And I think there's this, I mean, certainly, you know, when I'm at the dental school, there's this thinking, there's this mythology that it's the bacterial enzymes that are doing. And there are, I mean, to be fair, there are certainly, like with P. gingivalis, there are products produced by those bacteria that do act on the host. But for the most part, most of the damage is done by the host themselves. So they're not only enzymatic degraders, but they play all these other roles. We already went through this, so I'm just going to skip through this here. So, what produces the dysregulation of these cytokines? Anybody? Dysfunctional ECM, okay? And this gets us back, again, to those modifiable risk factors. So, actually, I borrowed this from another article that was talking about the role of T regulatory cells. But I adapted this for purposes of simplification. But my view here is that basically, perio is a result of this shift in the ECM. And that when the ECM is essentially on this, when it's over here, you know, you basically have, you have this stable balance between periodontal disease, between the microbiome, between the epithelial cells, between the immune system. Then, of course, when you start to get more dysfunction in the ECM, that direct contact with the basal cells starts to become altered, the immune function starts to become altered. I mean, all these things start to change. If you start changing the immune cells and the host cells, then, of course, the microbiome is going to change. So I really tend to look at this more from the standpoint of not, you know, bacteria are just opportunists. They're looking for a place to live. Certainly, you can get exposed to them, but if you have a robust immune system, okay, they're going to move on. But if they're swimming around there in some food that you happen to eat, and then they sense, oh, okay, this is a good place to live, that's where they're going to settle down. And for those of you who've done like the naturopath training, you recognize this disease evolution table. And of course, this has been recognized by the regulatory community for a long time. You know, this is nothing new. Periodontitis occupies this section right here on their charts. They call it periodontosis, though. All right. So in doing this, I came across this danger model of autoimmunity. When you look through the allopathic research stuff, this is starting to gain popularity. And I thought it was interesting because what I'm noticing is that as more and more research comes down, the allopathic community is starting to come closer to us. You know, they're starting to recognize that these autoimmune problems are not just this kind of dysfunction in these cytokines, but there's something else driving it. And they're recognizing that it's, they're calling it tissue-based. My contention is it's based on the ECM. So the first authors to recognize this were back, or Brancic and Krauss back in 1965. I mean, so we've known about this for a while. While the periodontal research community recognizes, I mean, this is the research community, they recognize this as, a, as an autoimmune disease, the AAP is loath to call it an autoimmune problem. I mean, I, you know, when I go in on Tuesdays, I sit next to the guy who's the head of the educational, well, not the educational, but for the certification for the when you become boarded as a periodontist. You know, and I talk to him, and I'm like, so, you know, we know all these things, so why don't we just call it an autoimmune problem? I don't know. That's a good question. Yeah, I mean, you know, it's like they really just don't want to go there. And I think in part just because they don't know how to deal with that. I think this group is much better positioned and suited to deal with those types of issues. So it's been 50 years. I mean, we know this, and this just kind of gives you a breakdown of all these different aspects, these autoimmune aspects that we recognize in periodontal disease. Right. So again, requires this homeostatic balance, has to be maintained to prevent us from basically destroying ourselves. Talk a little bit about these two particular cells here, about the gamma delta cells and the natural killer cells here. You can go back through this later, but it's just that I wanted you to, even though perio doesn't talk about this, I think this is probably one of these things we probably should talk more about in perio, is the role of these two particular cells, because they we know that they're involved in autoimmunity. And the, one of the reasons, and especially on the natural killer cells, I didn't have her permission to use her images here, but I've got this, she's 29 years old, is Bob here? Harris? No. He referred me to this patient. 29 years old, excellent oral hygiene, clean diet. She has Lyme disease. She's been treated for that, but her mouth is simply falling apart. It's just like her, like someone is like taking acid or something. I mean, there's no inflammation, but you can just see the tissues are just melting away from around it. And she's had treatment by various periodontists already, people trying to do implants and things in this woman's mouth. And she's just at a loss of what to do. And frankly, when I saw her, I was at a loss to do anything with her as well. We ran the bacterial test. She wasn't really showing much on the bacteria. But she did happen to go to the, what's the clinic again I mentioned to you the other night? I always forget their name. Up in Minnesota, Mayo Clinic. I don't know why I can't remember that. Mayo Clinic, and they ran this extensive test. And on the test, I just happened to notice that she had a natural killer cell deficiency. I thought, well that's interesting. No one ever mentioned it. I mean, I talked to her physicians, and I thought, so that's what got me started. And I started to notice that, yes, I mean, natural killer cell deficiencies can start to lead to these types of autoimmune problems. Now, does that mean I know what to do? No. I sent her to my integrative guy. I was like, you know, go see him because I have no idea what to do with that. So if a pathogen gets past this innate immune system because of a poor ECM, of course, then the adaptive immune system will come to play a more play a role in a more significant manner. The innate immune cells, such as dendritic cells, will already have been stimulated by the presence of the pathogens. It'll be prepared to offer up a piece of the invader to these naive T helper cells, these what are sometimes called T helper zero or CD4 plus cells, plus cytokines, plus major histocompatibility complex too. So this just gives you a bit of a breakdown. So those of you who are familiar with this, you know, this particular entity here, realize that this complex has to be established before you then start to differentiate into one of these particular types of T helper cells. Now, the determination of whether this cell goes off to as a Th2, Th1 is determined by the cytokines that you see here on these arrows going through this area. All right, so obviously if you have, and for most of our perio patients, when you start to look at, you know, which direction they go, most of them have this Th2. Not always, but they tend to go this direction right here. So you can only, this only occurs if you form the synapse, basically what's being described here. This goes through and just shows you, you know, that you have the primary T cell receptor binding to the major histocompatibility complex 2, T cell co-stimulatory receptor, and the secreted cytokines. Right? The T effector cells, though, they can then act in a manner then to also start to affect both B cells and macrophages in both the lymphoid and the non-lymphoid spaces. The reason this becomes significant for perio is that B cell infiltration is, when you look on those histology slides of chronic periodontal disease, what do you see? It's mainly B cell infiltrate, all right? And it can also upregulate the macrophage. Now, the interesting thing, and this I just found out like a few months ago, you know, there's this dogma that the only cells that can break down bone are the osteoclasts. Not true. We know that now macrophages can break down bone. So this, you know, I don't think it's just coincidental, though, that, you know, both the B cells and these macrophages can go in and start breaking down bone and connective tissue. So the T effector cells, they'll continue their clonal expansion as long as there's persistent stimulation by a pathogenic threat due to for local tissues, conditions. You know, Dr. Quigg was talking earlier about, you know, these gateways just opening up, letting a few through, and then shutting back down. Basically, I think what's going on is that you have leaky mouth syndrome. You know, the gates are open. You just pour in, and then you just get this chronic stimulation, just keeps going and going and going, until you do something to try to undo it. All right, so it's going to just continue until tissue conditions change or until this is downregulated by the Treg cells. So let's talk about the Treg cells. These are formerly known as T suppressor cells. They suppress T effectors, that is, you know, the T helper, T killer cells. They maintain tolerance of self-antigens, prevent autoimmune disease. They have these, I'm sorry, this probably can't see, what happened there? Okay, all right, sorry. You know, you have these biomarkers, CD25. These are thought to be derived from these naive CD4 cells. Transforming growth factor beta is necessary for the differentiation, though, of these. And again, you know, you're forming, again, this complex, kind of like you are with the T effector cells, right down here. All right, we've got the major histocompatibility complex 2, and then you've got, you can see it right here, you've got the T receptor, you've got the, basically these, this, it's kind of hard to read, CD80 and CD86 right here, all right? So I've read this quote here, and I thought this was actually on a blog, by the way, and so I put this down in here because I thought this was an interesting way this guy was describing it. They're the military police of the immune system. They patrol around the body searching for T or B cells that recognize antigens the Treg knows that are non-pathogenic. When they find them, they suppress their activity in a number of ways and or to induce them to sacrifice themselves through cell suicide. Interesting, okay. And this just goes through and describes then all these particular mechanisms that it tends to, you know, kind of influence these T effector cells to quit doing what they're doing. All right, so we've got all these marvelous regulatory systems, but, you know, the basic take-home message I want to convey here is that, you know, we need to think about what is causing this dysregulation. And that's where we start to get in then to the practical diagnostic and practical treatment considerations on this. And mind you, this is not comprehensive. I mean, we could spend on any particular aspect of this, I think we could spend like a whole day. So, I mean, if we just wanted to talk about oxygenation, I think we could spend a whole day talking about that. We could spend a whole day talking about toxins. So just understand, this is just kind of a real overview on this, on the practical diagnostic considerations. So, of course, charting, I always find photos useful because, you know, you can go back when you're taking clinical photos, then if a patient says, well, I don't know, did I have that before? Okay, you go back, look at the old photos. So I think intraoral photography is one of those key elements to my practice that really has helped things out quite a bit. The bacteria microscope is fine. I think it's a good tool. My only caution there is I think we can sometimes be led into a, how can I say, kind of a false sense of security with the because when you think about these particular types of infections, they're down in the dermis. I mean, they're not existing up on top. They're not in the plaque. I mean, they're facultative anaerobes. You know, they don't like being up top with everybody else. They want to be down in the connective tissue. So I think microscope can be fine to kind of educate patients, but I don't know that I would use it as like a definitive diagnostic tool to say, hey, you know, your periodontal disease is cured. And I think the same holds true for the oral DNA test, by the way, too. The genetics, the Celsus 1 genetics, I think is interesting. I don't use it that much, but I do use it on occasion when we're trying to make a big decision about a patient who's got rather advanced periodontal disease, and we're trying to figure out, you know, do we want to try to maintain the patient, or do we perhaps want to look at doing implants? You know, and if their Celsus 1 profile comes back as having a lot of SNPs that are going to tend to lead them towards progressive periodontitis, then, okay, you know, we may want to consider doing implant therapy rather than trying to maintain the dentition. I didn't put up the name of the test for this, and if you want to know about it, come and talk to me later. The only reason I'm not putting it up is that it comes out of Germany, and it's not available in this country. There's a patent on this particular technology. It's associated with Dr. Boyd Haley stuff, by the way. But the thing is, with this particular test, they don't have an international patent, so it's used over in Europe, and I get it from Germany, sent over here, and then use it in my office. But it basically tests for certain bacterial proteins and byproducts. Food allergy testing, I think, can sometimes be useful, especially if you're trying to determine what kind of diet the patient should be on. There's an active MMP8 test, and I don't know if any of you have ever heard of this, but it was developed by Timo Sorsa, and it's an interesting test, especially, you know, if you're looking at, you know, the action of the PMNs. I don't think it's necessarily definitive for perio, but I do think it's useful. This just shows, oh boy, that came out terrible. Sorry about that. This was supposed to show the Celsus 1, but I didn't realize it was so bad. But if you go to their website for the oral DNA, they'll show you one of these tests here. So from a whole body standpoint, basically, you want to clean up the ECM. Drainage and detoxification therapies first. And actually, I meant to put in the dietary stuff here before this. I didn't think the slides got mixed up. Ozone treatment can be of use in this effort. It's going to help to do a number of different things. Those of you who are familiar with ozone know all about this. Okay. Actually, I meant to put the diet in there first. So I always talk about just these basic four things for a patient presenting with perio: wheat, sugar, wheat, corn, and dairy. Corn, because of lipophosphates. I mean, most of this stuff is, you know, GMO. Dairy, just because, you know, most people's dairy is not some, you know, something they get from directly from the farmer. It's been processed and has all kinds of problems with incorporating into the diet. Eliminate the processed foods, probiotic foods, fermented vegetables. If they do, I like actually the beetroot, rather than sauerkraut, because the beetroot has beets in it. Beets help promote nitric oxide levels, especially fermented beets. Prebiotic foods, which I'm sure most of you know about. Organic grass-fed meats because of higher CLA levels. Healthy fats. And then periodic fasting. Again, something I've learned from my integrative partner about how this helps to upregulate regenerative cells. Toxins, this is just going through, the ways in which toxins can basically act on the ECM, that we really need to think about, cleaning this area up of any heavy metals. Especially, when you look at these perio patients that they've got like a ton of amalgams in their mouth. I mean, I think that was one of the things that really just, where I just gave up trying to work with general dentists. I mean, I work with general dentists now, but they're all on the same wavelength as I am as far as getting rid of mercury fillings and so forth. Because, you see all those sitting in there and that's helping to drive the periodontal disease. Stress is a factor in this. The psychoneuroendocrine immunology. So again, you want to make sure that the patient's neurological system is in balance. And there's any number. I mean, again, we could spend a whole day just talking about stress-related issues in periodontal disease. Excess cortisol production causes degeneration of the ECM. Decreases central serotonin levels. I'm just going to mention on here that there was a whole deal that I saw in a journal article was talking about why certain drugs, like Prozac and so forth, why it tends to cause more problems with implants. There's two big review studies that came out saying if you're using these certain drugs, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, that if you're using that you're going to have more problems with early implant loss. And their theory on this was that early loss is because of the increase in serotonin levels. I'm thinking, well, that doesn't make any sense. I mean, increased serotonin should help healing. It doesn't inhibit it. And they're giving all these wild reasons why increased serotonin. The problem was in their serotonin. If you know anything about the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, most of them are what? Fluoride drugs. Right? Now I see Dave Kennedy in here. Dave, right? Fluoride drugs, right? Most of them. I think it's except one of them. These people are basically being fluoride poisoned. That's the reason. It's not because of serotonin. All right, so once you're D&D therapies, you're going to make certain gains with that, but then if you have continuing immunological problems, you may need to consider the fact that they may have certain amount of immunologic rigidity. Most of the periodontal patients have this kind of Th2 type of rigidity. However, you can have Th1 as well. So what you need to do is you need to look at their comorbidities to figure out on which side they're existing. Again, for the dentist, you're just going to have to work with your medical partner to try to figure this out. There are certain homeopathic injections, certainly like transforming growth factor beta. But then the other thing that I've been exposed to, again, through my physician partner, and I keep saying physician partner, I'm just going to point him out there, Kevin Logan. Okay, just raise your hand there, Kevin. I've learned a lot from this guy. So, I hope that most of you are fortunate enough to have a partner that really kind of gets this stuff, because it's like having a good dance partner. I mean, then you really start to, get patients moving forward when you both are kind of on the same page. So he's the one that kind of got me introduced to this peptide therapy. And again, I'm not going to go into extensive amount of this, but basically this uses this amino acid sequence that's basically to irreversibly bind either the major histocompatibility complex 1 or 2, and it just sits on that receptor and basically starts to prevent the activation of these T effector or T reg cells. So for 3 weeks after these patients get this injection, not all of them. This is for the patients where this is the problem. They'll feel great for 3 weeks. I mean, my mother-in-law has rheumatoid arthritis. She goes and gets one of these shots. The next day, she's like moving around and she's back to her old self for about a month, and then she has to go back and get another shot. So it's a great therapy, and I do think it has some. We haven't really studied it in terms of periodontal disease, but I would be interested in kind of pursuing that more. All right, so ECM is the stage upon which this whole battle between pathogens and the host immune system is played out. So whether this becomes a tragedy or romantic comedy depends on how you feed the actors. Right, through diet, exercise, detoxification, stress reduction. We want a diverse, cooperative, commensal microbiome that will help protect us. We don't necessarily want them to... We don't want to kill everything. And that's the other take-home message. Okay? The epithelium is a multi-story building. So if we look at it, you know, in these terms, the most superficial layer is the roof. We want this kind of diverse, green, healthy rooftop. Keeps the rest of the building cool, free of toxic runoff. We want residents, the epithelial immune cells functioning and cooperating to protect the building and the foundation. Of course, that foundation is supplied and reinforced by a basement that's occupied by these janitors, the dermal immune cells, to help keep the basement clean. It's my best analogy. Okay, so where do we go from here? So, again, I'm just presenting this model up. I think we need to continually test this, submit it to different types of scrutiny. And again, this is for understanding of not just periodontal disease, but other oral and medical diseases as well. So I welcome your input. If you have ideas, suggestions, again, I'd be interested in hearing them.